by our community. So I speak in opposition to the amendments. Thank you. Ms. Sid Ho. Mr. Deputy, thank you. Good, you'll be in the chamber, because in a moment I'm going to respond to your earlier speech on the Create Smart initiative. But first of all, let me respond to Mr. Ben Chen. He said there are several ways to filibuster. One way is to waste a bit of time. Now, and he says sometimes even if we have a debate, it's a waste of time. Well, if he thinks that there are reasons forwarded in debate and it should be something good, is it really a waste of time? Now, the government is bypassing the Finance Committee and over 20 items of expenditure which should be funding proposals for the Finance Committee are now bundled with the budget, and the Labour Party has to mention these items. Of the 20-odd items, the majority of them have been considered by the relevant panels. Now, for the Create Smart initiative, for instance, in the paper submitted to the panel, it said that the proposal would be submitted to the Finance Committee for consideration, but now this is bundled with the budget. So these are items we could have supported, but we won't get a chance to ask questions or to debate or to offer suggestions on improving the arrangement. So that's why for these items, we have proposed to amendments to cut the budget for these items, because they represent those that bypass the Finance Committee. So I must remind the pro-establishment camp, you mustn't raise your hand wrongly. You have to look at each amendment carefully. We don't mean to cut the budget as such, but because the government tries to evade any questions, that's why we are moving amendments here. So therefore, in this council, we have the platform for us to give our views on these items and also to ask questions if necessary. And I would like the secretary to put on record this. In future, doesn't matter who will be re-elected again, and then for future members, they will have records of these proceedings and they can follow up as necessary.
There actually was a very good example that happened last week, that we could make the government disclose more information, is in relation to launches of the AFCD. When we spoke, we asked Dr. Ko Wing Man, the secretary, to answer. It was good of him, because he has a sense of responsibility. He said that in 2013-14, the funding allocation was already made to purchase the launch. However, the procurement process was very slow. As a result, albeit, notwithstanding funding has already been given, although there is no filibustering or anything, the procurement cost has increased by $4 million. Had we not asked questions, no one would have known. Perhaps the loyalists in the EXCO did not have time to talk about this, to talk about the $4 million. Well, if there is inefficiency resulting in public money spending, then we have the responsibility to ask questions so that it can be followed up in the future. And if you just label all amendments as filibustering, it is not fair. There are funding applications that have circumvented the monitoring of the government, and we could only move amendments so that it will be discussed. So you should not just blindly vote for or against a certain amendment. We should not be a rubber stamp, but if you blindly vote for or against without considering the item, then you become a rubber stamp. I want to respond to what Ma Feng Kok said, Mr. Deputy, about smart initiatives. Well, even if I'm not inside the chamber, I would be listening to what was said, including what you said and what Mr. Andrew Leung said. You both have replied on some specific issues on Create Smart Initiatives. The Labour Party support the creative industry. In relation to the additional $400 million to be injected into the Create Smart Initiatives to continue support of the creative industry, that we support. Mr. Deputy, you made a comment, and it was a very good comment, but if we did not move the amendment, you would not have the chance to make that comment. You should thank us for making the amendment. Apart from one or two main events, that is the digital entertainment and the sign, when a lot of people may have made applications, when it comes to construction, publication, TV, music, publication, there aren't many applications. For some, only 1 to 3 applications. And I repeat what you've said. Why is there an uneven distribution? Is it because the government has not enhanced communication with the trade? That's why these industries with great potential did not know about the availability of support from these Create Smart initiatives. Well, if the event, if the proposal did not go, do not go to the FC, we would not have a chance to ask questions. And I asked Greg So, the secretary, to undertake to prepare a paper as if it's going to the finance committee to reply to our questions. When it comes to publication and printing, it used to be Hong Kong's major industry. It could have done better, especially in the Chinese-speaking world, say Hong Kong and Taiwan, we use the traditional characters. I don't mean to say that if it's a simplified character, it should be chucked. No, there are many good books printed in simplified characters, and there are a lot of rubbish read that is printed in traditional characters. We have freedom of the press here. We have freedom of publication here. We have the market of all Chinese-speaking societies. If we can attract quality books to come to Hong Kong to have their first print, then we are successful. How come we can't do it? I agree with what you've asked, Mr. Deputy, and I would like the government to seriously follow this up. In relation to what Mr. Andrew Leung said, he did not ask many questions, and he said that the Create Smart Initiative has done this and that. And I would like to hear from the government. Despite what they have done, there are some projects that have stopped. According to the information given to the panel, that is the last one, July 2015, they said that there is a program, there is a cooperation between the design industry and the business sector. It stopped. Perhaps the government wanted to stop something that they thought was a mistake. According to the information paper, they said that the program has done its job and a lot of applications were not approved. Say there are only 21 projects approved in 2014-15, totaling $780,000. However, they have spent an unproportional amount to vet these applications. And there is a very high failure rate of applications. And we want to ask, what are the reasons? Is it the case that these proposals were not feasible, or is it a technical matter? When you receive the proposal, you realize that it is not up to standard. Should you refer it to an expert group to teach them and guide them, bring them back to the right course, so that it will be commercially viable? There's one saying that is very good. The pig can only gain weight when you feed it. If there are people who make proposals, and when the rejection rate is so high, shouldn't you find out the reason? Why the proposals were rejected? Or were there any brilliant ideas amongst them? And the failure only lies in technicalities? We need to have a platform to ask questions so that we can improve the promotion of the creative industry. In the same paper, and there is also mention of the Design Center, the Hong Kong Design Center, in reply to report number 62 of the Audit Commission. The Audit Commission raised questions over 46 paragraphs about conflict of interest, information on the internet, on the website, that being inaccurate. And also the scope of subsidy that is not even. And there are two areas that I would like to talk about. And I want to hear from the government about what they have done. Paragraph 4.28C of the Audit Commission's report, that is organizations, successful organizations, and the agreements involved. The audit thinks that some of the terms are outdated and unnecessary, and that is something that the Design Center to review. The Design Center told us that they have sought advice from the DOJ and they're reviewing it, and there will be some amendments. But what are the amendments? We want to know. We want to follow it up. Will there still be some unnecessary and outdated terms and requirements after the revision? Will they have gone excessive the other end? That would give rise to abuse? Will the subvented parties use the money on items that are not supposed to be paid by public money? We want to know the details. There is also another area, is a new point I would like to hear from the Secretary. That the subvented party did not open a dedicated account to deal with the subvented amount. When the point was made, maybe it was right, but now we see that it's not just new political parties, civic bodies, or business organizations. Even NGOs that's got a check from the government, it could not open an account. There is a letter from the government expressing its support still. The account could not be opened because in recent years the banks have stepped up on combating money laundering. So there are a lot more hurdles. Banks have to spend a lot of manpower and resources to prevent money laundering. So we want to know, how are these follow up? The subvented parties, do they have difficulties opening bank accounts? I want to hear from government officials. At least there should be an undertaking that there will be a written reply. Mr. Martin Liu. 4 years in a row, there has been filibustering with the appropriation bill. This time, we're not surprised. In the individual debates, including this one, a number of members from the opposition moved a number of amendments to reduce expenditure of policy bureaus or departments, reduction of personal emolument of directors, the chief executive, and secretaries is nothing new. But this year, they have gone so over the top that they asked to reduce expenditure relating to fire engines or something that is essential to saving lives. Ray Chan said that the fire services department is his favorite department of all. But he asked to take away the annual expenditure of the FSD. Does it mean that the firefighters don't have a family to support? I do think that firefighters can feel his sincerity.
Well, these are attempts to deprive the government of necessary resources to enable the departments to operate. But they are not offering alternatives to prevent the vacuum of government. And they have not shown that doing so would improve governance. And in the debate on our economy, we also have many ridiculous amendments. Fortunately, we have the loyalists, we have the functional constituencies, and in the split voting system, these amendments will not be carried. Mr. Deputy, as I said in the second reading debate, Hong Kong's economy is facing threats within and without. And our economic growth has been adjusted downwards. The IMF has adjusted down our growth rate from 3.4% to 3.2%, and World Bank from 3.2% to 2.9%, or 3.3% to 2.9%. Our exports are declining. Our tourism and retail sectors are facing downturns. According to a recent survey, the business sentiment factor or index for SMEs. We have seen a record low for years, and the 300 of thousands of SME may not survive. Those in the retail sector are particularly affected. This year, we're only expecting a growth rate of 1.2%, which is even worse than the 2.4% we had last year. Apart from the macroeconomic climate, we have the occupation movement, the riot in Mongkok, and the aftermath is beginning to affect us. And therefore, the business sector would like to implement the policies in the budget to stimulate the economy, to protect, to support the SMEs, and keep our jobs. But these amendments are doing exactly the opposite. The tourism industry is suffering, according to latest statistics, the number of tourists has dropped for 10 consecutive months. Although in the May Day Golden Week, we have seen some increase. There was a 10% of mainland tourists coming to Hong Kong, but number of tours has dropped by half. And we have also got
negative news such as zero fare shopping tours. We should do more to get rid of the malpractice so as to promote the tourism growth. The latest unemployment rate stood at 3.4%. The retail sector is performing poorly. And yet the amendments proposed would mean cutting the whole year expenditure of the CEDB. As a result, the policies to stimulate the tourism and the retail sector will not be able to be proceeded with. This would deal a second blow to the relevant sectors. Hong Kong's status as a international financial center is subject to challenges. According to the latest GFCI, our ranking has dropped below third. The government must adopt new thinking to enhance our competitive edge. For example, we should find ways to promote fintech. And yet there are amendments to cut the personal emoluments of all staff in the FSTP. And we are doing a catching up game in creative industry and innovation, but there are amendments to cut the personal emoluments for all the staff in the IT bureau. We have been saying that Hong Kong has a economic structure which is not diversified, and cutting these expenditure items would just affect the development of innovation. And then this progression ladder for young employees will be affected. Have the opposition come consider this? But the members who are filibustering have forgotten to take this into account, because they will know very well that the amendments have got no chance of being passed. Or worse still, they don't really want to get the amendments passed, because if that happens, Hong Kong will be even more seriously affected. Well, in fact, they are doing something at low cost, which would benefit them, and so they would continue with the filibustering, request quorum calls, and waste our time, and try to ridicule their opponents, and to steal some limelight and media coverage. But they have no more tricks to offer. They can only use the old tricks, and Hong Kong's well-being is taken hostage. The president has this year allocated a specified time frame for each debate. And therefore, they may not be able to delay the passage of the bill to the extent that the services would be affected. But actually, in this farce, what they are doing would demean this council. Well, there's a high social cost to pay, and everyone suffers because of this. They are irresponsible. Whether the public support them or not, everyone would have to show bear the consequences. Some members say that they don't support filibustering, but they are not doing anything to stop it. So everyone knows the ulterior motives behind. Someone asks why we are not doing something to stop this. My answer is that it takes more than the council to stop the filibustering. The real power to stop this rests with voters. If you don't treasure your votes, which you are given once every 4 years, then there's no way it can be stopped. It has been said that the amendments are moved in order to arouse public attention on government policies. If that's the case, why are you continuously asking for quorum cause. And even if there is substance in your arguments, what would catch public attention is the tactic of filibustering and the out-of-the-way acts and behavior. This will lead this council astray, and our constitutional role will be affected, and therefore public credibility will be affected. This is just about putting up a show. What can it serve? What good purpose can it serve apart from causing delays? The answer is clearly no, nothing. And Hong Kong people would have to bear the consequences. According to the basic law, this council's one of the functions of this council is to scrutinize and approve the budgets. But actually, the opposition are turning this constitutional duty into a farce. And even some of them, their supporters, are saying that they are not doing some things radically enough. How can a community survive and prosper with so much conflict in the council? And sometimes the degradation starts from within. And the filibustering that we have seen is undermining this council, and there will be nothing beneficial for this council and the community. I oppose to these unreasonable and ridiculous amendments. Ms. Elizabeth Quart, Mr. Deputy, today we are still facing filibustering and the continual request for quorum calls from 2012 up to now. How many times do we face filibustering and a quorum calls and also motion of adjournment? Altogether, we have 346 hours on average. We spend $200,000 a month, an hour, sorry, $200,000 an hour on council business. So altogether, it would mean a cost of $66 million, which can be spent on better things. According to those members who are filibustering, they are saying that there are so many problems in Hong Kong, and whatever they do, they cannot make things better. That's why they have to do this. But we have been doing this, we have been facing this for 4 years, and they are doing this every year with respect to the budgets, and we have wasted $66 million. And what have we accomplished? What problems have been solved through filibustering? Maybe Mr. Raymond Chan can explain in a moment. Such acts are nothing but counterproductive. We have met people from the construction sector because they've seriously affected by filibustering. Annually, the construction sector would require a total of $180 billion worth of projects. And every year, we would grant approval for $70 billion worth of public works project to be granted. In 2011-12, we approved projects worth 167.7 billion, 12, 2012, 2013, $90.9 billion, 13-14, well, it was spared, $3.6 billion, and then 14-15, $107.2 billion. So sometimes they had work to do, sometimes they don't. We have only approved $13 billion worth of project out of the $67.5 billion planned. And other sectors such as tourism, retail, and catering are now facing a downturn, a serious winter of a business downturn. And yet, members are continued with their filibustering. Many people find this really obnoxious. We have only got 2 more months to go for the current term. I think the public have a right to expect that this council sees reasons and we have a good debate and promote good policies instead of filibustering all the time or personal attacks of political opponents or through moving amendments level insults on officials. Such negative comments would continue to adversely affect Hong Kong. There would be a lot of negative energy around. It won't make Hong Kong people happier. Well, where can you find a city, a country, or a family that has no problem? When there are problems, shouldn't we work together to solve them or bring each other? Well, the fighting among your own people won't solve problems. It's time we set aside our preconceived ideas. Don't expend your efforts on fighting. Let's work for the well-being of Hong Kong. I hope the members who are filibustering will stop it for the sake of Hong Kong. Hong Kong cannot bear the consequences. Mr. Deputy, I oppose all the amendments.
Mr. Raymond Chen. Thank you, Mr. Deputy. I've been listening to the pro-establishment camp members for half a day. I think they don't even understand what is meant by quorum. They do what is meant by quorum counts, not to mention filibustering. Let's get down to the basics. What is meant by quorum? Well, many experienced members have spoken, but I find that they didn't have a clear idea. Mr. Mlang Singh referred to Article 75 of the Basic Law. This is because the concept of quorum comes from the Basic Law. It says here, the quorum for the meeting of the Legislative Council of the Hong Kong SAR shall be not less than one half of all its members. Well, he is drawing on the word guihang, meeting. He takes it to mean the commencement of the meeting. Well, the legal advice from our in-house lawyers as well as consultants, they have said that meeting doesn't mean the commencement of the meeting, as Mlang Singh has interpreted it. If you care to read the English version.
Hong Kong Special Administration than one half of all its members. 没说呢, 开会, 投票,
it doesn't make a distinction between during the process, voting, etc. So from the start until the meeting is adjourned by the president, we need to maintain a quorum. But then in the past, we used to assume that a quorum was prevailing. But in front of the camera, you can see that when there is a headcount, there are just five of us. So how can you assume that there is a quorum? This is not my own interpretation. Mr. Paul Chair was fair when he made comments. Whenever something was put to the vote, he would ask for a division. And he did practice what he preached. At first, I didn't understand why he was sort of doing this. I thought he was trying to do something nasty. Well, in fact, he told us that he didn't want our legislative business being subject to judicial review or challenges. So he would be asking for a division. He would be claiming for a division every time when we didn't have a quorum at a time of voting. I haven't been upset by Chen Kamlam when he interrupted my speech. I thought, given his experience, he finally came to understand that whenever there was a lack of quorum, he had to ask for a quorum count. I would not mind it. I don't mind even if you do so five or seven times during my speech. Everybody, every one of us has the duty to make sure that there is a quorum. Now, you may think that, well, on this side, we haven't even got a couple of pen Democrats, you are fully entitled to ask for a quorum call. And then for Sterry Lee, she has been a member for a long time. She has even become the chairlady of DAB, but still she didn't understand it. She said that we were abusing their quorum calls. No, no, it isn't an abuse. What has happened is that for this council, very frequently we encounter a lack of quorum. What it means is that even the pro-establishment camp members would not want to sit here to listen to her. She asked the president, the chairman, to find a solution. What can the chairman do? What can the president do? The president has written an article saying that why every time there is a quorum call, we have to wait 40 minutes. I need to put a question back to you. Why can't you arrive on the 13th minute instead of the 14th minute, where everybody seems to think that it will be a waste of time if they come back earlier. And therefore, whenever a quorum is formed, they will just leave the chamber again. And saying you had the experience of drawing up a timetable, and you could also come up with a counter solution. That is, you could repeat what you did before. That is, for every hour you had your own recess of 15 minutes. Now, if you think that this is a waste of time and you try to tell us how many cans of luncheon meat we are wasting, then why don't you be ready every minute so that whenever the bell is rung, you can come back immediately? I've already said that this is not filibustering. Whenever there is filibustering, I'll admit it. I have said that when I ran for the post in 2012, I did admit it. But currently, there isn't any filibustering because the president has already dealt with the problem, dealt with the issue. So it's a matter of we have been ring-fenced and we were only restricted in what I would like to do. Now, Lan Guohong seems to be upset today and he has become very emotional. Well, just now when Sterry Lee spoke, I also had very strong reactions. She said that there was no point in filibustering because the DAB members had successfully acquired the $2 transport concession fare, and also the DAB were trying to lower the age limit for the elderly healthcare vouchers. And she also said that as a result of filibustering, we were unable to achieve a consensus over retirement protection. Is it because Lan Guohong is trying to put pressure on John Zhang, and John Zhang would like to put pressure on Sui Lan, but Sui Lan would rather not do it accordingly? Now, you say that the economy has come to a halt, and then the city is besieged. You now seem to blame everything on us and blame it on filibustering. I get angry. Now you're saying that there is a lack of consensus over retirement protection, all because of filibustering. And then you also referred to the waiving of the means testing for the old age living allowance. In 2012, we pledged our allegiance. And at that time, I didn't take part. Lan Guohong himself alone tried to get an improvement of the old age living allowance. We had asked for the waiving of the means testing, but then the DAB at that time said that the means limit of $186,000 should be lowered. And then the Liberal Party said $500,000, and then for the FTU, for those aged 70, the means testing should be waived, and we said that it should be lowered to 65. Had we joined hands, at least we could have lowered the asset limit to or raise it to $300,000. Now, we haven't got that. Either you spend it all, or you try to give it to your friend for custody, and then you may be cheated, and then even couples get they become broke up because they quarrel each other over their assets. So if you accuse us of failing to achieve anything out of filibustering, this is because when you want to get something, you will still not want to press the government. Now, for this year's budget, why haven't we got any rental waiver for the PRH tenants? You could have pressed the administration. Had you done so, John Zhang would have succumbed to your request, and then there will be an additional payment of CSSA assistance, and then there would be the 1 month rental waiver for the PRH tenants. How are we going to exert the greatest pressure on the government? Now you advise us against filibustering. You say that we shouldn't talk about retirement protection. All that we need to do is to lower the age limit to 65 so that they don't have to subject themselves to means testing for OAA. Now, we have been promised a review. Now, it will only be raised to $219,000 instead of $300,000 requested by DAB. Now, we asked for the progress of the review. Now, we are told that OAA won't be reviewed on its own. Rather, the whole system will be reviewed altogether. In other words, it means refusal to review. So, $219,000 will remain as the asset limit. In other words, it is still some way from $300,000 requested by DAB. Now, the DAB members would like to fight for a limit of $300,000. And FTU also said that the age limit should be lowered to 70. Lam Kok Hong became very upset and angry because of what you have done. Now, if we all go out together and ask for this to be done, I think it will be done. But you haven't, and you won't. And yet, you point a blaming finger against us, accusing us of failing to achieve anything in the filibustering. I want to address the points made by Wong Kwok Hing. I may not have sufficient time, because there are 5 minutes left. He said that filibustering has busted. I don't think you can really term it in this way. Well, if you ask for successful examples of filibustering, if you ask the citizens, what have we achieved? Well, for citizens, they would say that Article 23 on the Internet, that is the Copyright Amendment Bill, would be an example. On the 24th of February this year, we had the budget, and unprecedentedly, we continued with the meeting. And then there was a mistake in counting the number of members present, and so the meeting was aborted. On the following day, on the 25th, Gregory So said that for the overall well-being, he said that the Copyright Amendment Bill would be dropped if the bill could not be enacted in the following week. And then reporters called to me saying that we won. I said, no, don't say that. I won't open a bottle of champagne to say that we have succeeded. No, in fact, we have failed because we weren't able to have an open-ended exemptions. We spent 4 or 5 months on the amendment bill. The government would rather let it be dropped. There was some light when there was the four-party negotiation. Even the pro-establishment camp would like to narrow the differences. But Gregory So just became more and more stubborn. And he even said that the bill would be dropped. And not just for the current year, but for the current administration as well. That's why I have said that I would not come out to say that it's victory for us. Had we joined hands and asked the administration to agree with us to have more exemptions, then I would say that it's victory. For what we have done, for what we have got, at most you could say that we're able to counter the draconian bill. Yes, we have achieved something. Say, for example, for the Copyright Amendment Bill, we were able to withstand it for a period of time. And then other members quoted funny examples. Wong Kwok Hing talked about the popularity of his secondary creation, saying that it shows that he's popular and we are not popular. But for Christopher Chong and Ann Jeng's YouTube clips, again, they are very popular, so it's got nothing to do with the performance of lawmakers. And you talk about our popularity ratings that are falling. No, this is not true. In April, according to the Hong Kong U opinion poll, Lam Kwok Hong, Edward Chen, Raymond Wong, etc. are still within the top 10. For Wong Kwok Hing, you are still below the top 20 lawmakers despite years of work. You also, Wang Kok-hing, took the opportunity to showcase the work of the FTU. Now you had this poster saying that for paternity leave, you are saying that we are moving towards 7 days of full pay. Well, of course, it has been sort of parodied, saying that it is tantamount to agreeing to same-sex marriage. In 2012, when the FTU members ran for the elections, you talked about 7 days paternity leave. And then in 2014, when we scrutinized the bill from, I mean, the CSA from Kenneth Leung, that is making it full pay instead of 80% pay, Chen Yuanhan, Dang Ga Biu, Wang Guoqin, Alice Mack, etc. How did they vote? They didn't abstain. They simply pressed the present button. It's weird. They didn't even abstain and they didn't walk out. By walking out, they will reduce the denominator and it will still help. But they simply pressed the button of being present. In 2016, they still have the they still want to say that they are fighting for full pay for paternity leave. I just wonder why you are so bold to use this as the theme of your electoral campaign. When you spoke, you also talked about fighting for it for 10 years before you get 3 days paternity leave. Mr. Leung Kok-hong.
Well, just now, Ip Kok-him said, well, he's gone now, he... talked about my PRH unit, my public housing unit, and I need to respond. I think in a way he's saying that the housing department is irresponsible, not doing its work. Well, you have to exceed the both income and asset before you are not allowed to have a PRH unit. Well, that means over the years, I have not had any savings because my asset limit is always below the limit. I have put my money in my litigation fund. Well, you know that Chen Kam Lam and another member and Gary Chan bought a property in Taiwan. I reckon that Chen Kam Lam has made a profit of about $10 million. And you can see what they wear. And you realize that they wear expensive suits and expensive shoes. And of course, if you become rich as a result of being a legislator, of course, that is to be congratulated. Look at Gary Chan. He has bought a Porsche and he has also got another car. Well, his political party said that they are working for grassroots. However, a few years after you've become a legislator, you become rich. Well, what is the problem with me living in a PRH unit? If there is a problem, that means people who are PRH tenants have problems. Like I do. Well, they say FTU has fought a lot of things. Well, on the 24th of October 2014, the FTU said that he could not agree. To setting a means test by the government on OALA. 24th of October 2012, about 4 years ago. On the 7th of October in that year, I and some others filibustered to oppose to the means, to the asset limit. I asked for no asset limit as long as you're over 70 years old. You're eligible for the OALA. And of course, it could be lower to 65. The DAB thought that it should be 300,000 if that is a a means test, a Liberal Party, 500,000, and An Chang said, let's take the middle ground and let's just distribute the money evenly. It's been over 3 years. Will you clap your hands when the day the filibustering ended? What do people get? It's already past the 2015 district council election. What was your platform for district council during that year? I'm afraid you won't even mention it because you're too embarrassed. I remember after Tommy Jung had stopped the filibustering, I apologized to elderly people for my lack of experience and could not achieve my goal, and I hope that my mantle will be taken up. What is the problem? The problem is the OALA, the Old Age Living Allowance. Wong Kok Heng said in the last time, let me read out what he said towards the end. He said, thirdly, the government said that without a means test, the society will have to pay. The most important thing is to have retirement protection. The FTU, listen to this, 31 years ago asked the government to put in place a comprehensive retirement protection. And since 1984, we asked for a central provident fund. In 1994, we asked for a retirement protection for the elderly. And the government has been stalling. If I continue, he'll be more embarrassed. He said he started to ask for it 31 years ago, and he made himself sounded like he had vision. Well, he opposed to the colonial government. So we add 4 years to that. 35 years ago, he had the cheek to say that to accuse other members for filibustering. And they're fighting for what you've been asking for 35 years ago. Who are you to talk? People don't even ask you why you could not get what you want after 35 years. I feel embarrassed reading that. How come that Zhang Yuxing and Tam Yu Chung had the cheek to read that? Who's wrong? I was once a member of the FTU, and I listened to what you said to fight for retirement protection. And I'm doing what you say, what you advocate. Well, I remind you, Leung Kwok Hong. Well, but they did the same. You've spent more than 6 minutes doing that. I am a legislator. Maybe it's just because a petty grudge. CY Leung forced the OALA down our throat. It's not something I am happy to do. Shouldn't I continue to fight? I've been fighting for years. You can criticize me, but have you considered using me? Using me, what I said to help you? If I overturn the table, would you not set the table again? I have made everything very clear. People Power asked for $10,000 for each person. So we're talking about $50 billion. Or put the money in a universal retirement protection. Well, the government took $50 billion towards a fund, but now it's frozen. What other do we ask for? The standard working hours, the FTU has been slapped left, right, and center. And I also ask for standard working hours. The FTU has been slapped left, right, center. And that person said that Ng Cao Bak said, Ng Chao Bak said, from the FTU said, well, they humiliated us and we should leave the table and we should not return. During Tong Chi Wa, I was in a public gallery. I was shouting out and I was asked to leave about unemployment benefit. Universal retirement protection, pension, I fought for them. I admit that I have failed. It doesn't really matter that I fail. But if I fail, that means you all have failed. It was a dozen years ago when I was taken away. I asked for something and I still don't have it. Now I am a legislator. I have more ways to put pressure on the government. Should I not use my power? We have more than $600 billion in surplus. And that's excluding all the funds set up by John Zhang from the past 10 years. People Power asked for universal distribution, $10,000. I can wager you, if you ask people, would you oppose to $10,000? Do you think they will? Rates are waived. What about giving you $10,000? Well, maybe less, $6,000 like the other year. We're only talking about $30 billion. How am I wrong? Where am I wrong? Right, you're right. Starry Lee, Tam Yu Chung, and DAB is right when they said that, well, aren't we scared that it will be endorsed? Indeed. What happened before when they walk out ended up in a disastrous way, it may happen again. There may be another blunder which ends in the amendments being endorsed. The FS will ask you, what do we do to make it up? Then you say to him, well, can we have standard working hours? Can you take away a means test from the OALA? You may get what you want. Don't diddle Hong Kong people anymore. If you put your foot on the put your foot down, Hong Kong government will talk to you. Don't try to diddle Hong Kong people. If the appropriation bill cannot be endorsed, if they can't get what they want, and if they have to reintroduce it, and if it's still not endorsed, then LegCo will have to be disbanded. Well, then Ray Chen and I myself will not be able to come back to get in your way. What's most depraved of a person, you know full well, that sitting here will stop us from cutting the expenditure. And you know full well that is not going to happen. And yet you said that we want that done. I've told you a million times that under the basic law, we cannot increase government expenditure, save and except that we have an approval from the chief executive. You know him. You asked him for an approval to get more money for dental services all over the territory. Because if CY Leung said yes, it goes. He refuses. That's why I wanted to force his hands by cutting expenditure. You try to lie to Hong Kong people. It's not that easy. I know a lot of firefighters. I play football with them. I have hundreds of WhatsApp from them. Stop lying to people. You talk about improving the terms for firefighters. And he said that no additional manpower, no additional resources. And they said that there is no change in policy, no additional manpower or additional resources, then they will get improvement of terms of service, a reduction in hours. But how is that possible? You said that there won't be additional manpower, additional resources, no change of policy. As long as that is done, you come up with something and then we will endorse it. You said you fight for them. But you're actually defending the government. Well, I'm different. If you don't ask CY Leung for the approval to give us more money, you can actually say to him, if you don't give us more money, well, we won't give you money. We will endorse some of the amendments. That's how you get what you want. Are you cheating and lying to Hong Kong people? There is also another point. Reduction of pay. The government said, well, if you reduce personal emolument in a subhead, it may not be against the director you have in mind. And if that is the case, then you hold him accountable. Do you understand or not? Are you so thick that you don't understand? Do you have to take what you're given? I cut FS pay. He can take other people's salary to pay for his, but that is wrong, and you can hold him accountable. And you can censure him. Let me tell you that, well, I am honorable when it comes to living in a PRH unit. I am not like other legislators. Once they become legislators, they profit from it. They will drive Mercedes Benz and live in big houses.
Mr. Deputy, I request a quorum count. Thank you.
Dr. Kuo Ka-Kee,
thank you, Chairman. I want to speak on the proposed cut of the personal emoluments of SHA and as Secretary for Education. In recent days, we have seen a lot of discussion of youth policies. We have young political aspirants who have been talking about the independence of Hong Kong, and they have been severely criticized for breaking the law, although there's no such law prohibiting such remarks.
Why hasn't the administration done any soul searching? Why is there such a huge degree of agony towards the SARG as well as the Central People's Government? Mr. Chairman, your younger brother, the former Secretary for Home Affairs, left the administration. It was rumored that CY Leung had to sacrifice somebody, and so your brother was chosen. Lau Gonghua, please don't be too happy too early. Your boss would not spare you. You might easily become another scapegoat if it is found that youth work is not properly carried out. Well, for Mr. Lau, in fact, your popularity rating has never reached a satisfactory level. It may have to do with you personally, but you have to accept the reality because you are part of the team. Now, for Lau Gonghua, Secretary for Home Affairs, well, there are many occasions for you to set the record straight. Unfortunately, other than scandals like that related to the Permanent Secretary, as well as the removal of the reference to national in the title of somebody's educational qualification in the CV. Well, in fact, graduates from universities in Taiwan and also graduates from overseas universities can see for themselves what has happened. It means that you may go to please the Central People's Government, and you won't observe any limits. Now, in fact, it was in a brochure for a performance that somebody would like to include reference to a national university in Taiwan as part of her educational qualification. Still, it wasn't allowed. Now, the SHA last month told us that he had to undertake some investigation and would give an answer to us later on. Now, a month has already passed, and still you haven't given us any reply. Now, we are all having our speeches broadcast. So, either today or tomorrow, please tell us what is the outcome of your investigation. Now, if the administration would want to continue with this sort of political censorship or politicizing everything and resort to political means to force the cultural sector and the youth population to succumb to you, then you would only be advocating more people to harbor independence of thoughts. So it is right to say that CY Leung is the father of Hong Kong independence. If CY Leung remains in the post for any longer, the mood of independence would just escalate. Now, for the HAB, you are supposed to take care of our sports policies and cultural policies. First of all, sports. We have got the SFNOC, Sports Federation and Olympic Committee. It has always been affected by scandals. In 2009, as a result of personal conflicts, a particular person was not chosen to become part of the national squad of judo. And then for the fencing team, Zhao Jike was ranked 14th in the World League, and yet Zhao was not chosen to represent Hong Kong, and that resulted in the departure of the athlete forever. Well, this is very outrageous when you look at the history of the SF and OC. It has been set up for 60 years or more. There were two or three deputy chairmen who are in their 90s, and then we have got the post being passed from the father to the son, like Mr. Pang Chong. He's 76 or 77 years old. He has been in the post for 21 years, and then he said that he won't retire before the age of 80. So, in fact, such office bearers are not promoting sports. They are, in fact, standing in the way of our sports development. Ma Feng Guo is not here, and probably as a result of the small circle election, is going to favor the pro-government camp, so we don't see any change in sight. But then, what sort of a price do we pay for this? It is the sports development of Hong Kong. Now, the government would tolerate this kind of cronyism, and for decades, it remains so. It has remained so without any change. I think many of the office bearers of the SF and OC would rather remain in the post and try to get more medals and honors. Now, the SALG has been importing sportsmen into Hong Kong, and then they become local sportsmen. Well, it will be good because they can achieve excellence on your behalf. But fortunately, in recent years, our young people, despite all the frustration, despite the import of mainlanders into Hong Kong, they have not given up. And for their own dreams, to pursue their own dreams, they have exerted their best, and therefore we have got many excellent athletes like cyclists and even swimmers that have become qualified for the Olympic Games. Probably it's the government that hasn't changed, and also those sports associations that are at the mercy of the government and trying to get subvention from the government. In fact, for us to train our athletes, we need to start at a young age. For the HEB and the Education Bureau, they don't talk. They operate on different paths. Therefore, we see that young people don't have venues for their ball games, and for schools, their playgrounds are still closed to the public. We have got hundreds of school playgrounds and ball courts. They're supposed to be open to the public after school hours and during the weekends. But no, they are not open to the public. And the government won't care about it. The government doesn't care whether young people have places to go to. We try to ask for policy assistance from the government department involved. We hope that they can persuade and make the schools open the facilities to the public, in particular the young, but to no avail. We used to have the music office, and unfortunately, many training programs have been suspended. And as a result, the development has come to a standstill. For those in the grassroots community, people living in Yunlong, Tinsui, and Dongchong, quite unlike the middle-class families and quite unlike the director bureaus who can afford to pay a private coach and who can send their children to elite schools overseas, the grassroots families cannot afford the expensive tuition fees. And then, of course, the education reform has failed. Our educational system is just excessively competitive. Just a small handful of students can get good results, and all the others have sacrificed along the way, and they don't see any future at all. So education has failed, sports is just window dressing, and then you don't have a future if you are interested in music or arts. At the same time, you're blaming the young, saying that they shouldn't be that radical. I think the government should do some soul searching, and then you won't ask this question. Do we have any creative industries or cultural industries for our young generation? What about the LCSD? Recently, we have the latest scandal about the Philharmonic Orchestra. It has received a lot of subvention from the government, and then the financial director has awarded a contract to his daughter. It is outrageous. It is just an example of the style of governance of this government. This is because the leading class or the ruling class doesn't set a good example. If the leader exercises privileges, then the subordinates would follow suit. So if you have a post and if you have some power, some privileges, of course you need to make full use of them. That's what Siwa Leung has taught us. And you can also turn towards the north and try to make more use of the privileges. It is a very bad precedent and a bad example. I think the young, the cultural sector, etc., have a lot of hatred and hostility towards the government. So don't blame the young people for harboring independent thoughts. I think the government itself is to be blamed. Now, for the SFNOC, we have been asking for the organization to be reformed. Mr. Zhong and Mr. Lui have already said that the government should no longer be protecting the SFNOC. If you allow this to continue, it will just become more corrupt, and dedicated young people will just leave sports. They would stay away from this corrupt organization. They don't want to fight against such people. They would rather choose something else. Now, the government has turned a blind eye to this for many years. Yes, we have elite athletes in different kinds of sports, but the grassroots can't have access to such. Do you subsidize the use of venues? And what about PE lessons for our children? We can't even have an additional physical education class. And then what about our secretary for education? He will only be interested in overseas trips. He will tell you about the best sushi in Japan. He would visit the Japanese-style supermarkets, and he will read magazines. Other than that, I don't know what else can be said of him. The education reform is a total failure, and still they will embrace it and will not think of any improvements. Of course, the ruling team won't be hurt because the children are all overseas. The community at large will suffer, in particular the low-income class, especially the grassroots families. I've said this many times. In Hong Kong, we are not able to produce elite students, and we are not able to help those who are disadvantaged. 10% of the children have learning difficulties, attention deficiency or other types of learning difficulties. Does the government take care of them? The government has such a bad policy that it won't do anything on its own, and it will only resort to the community care fund to do some stopgap measures. I think there should have been school-based psychologists and also school-based social workers to help the disadvantaged. Mr. Chairman, in the past 5 years, we have got 70% more teenagers seeking mental health treatment. So our educational system would only turn out more failures and more people will become suicidal. This is regrettable. Ms. Sitholm.
Hi.
Thank you. In the fifth and the sixth debate, I have moved 9 amendments, 2 of which relates to the allowance and personal emolument of secretaries. A lot of people have spoken on their performance, and I will focus on items, funding applications that have circumvented the Finance Committee. In my last round, I replied to what Mr. Ma Fung Kwok said. He's from the culture and publication sector. It's about the $110 million injection to the Create Smart initiatives. And I'd like to say once again that our moving of the amendments is not to cut the funding allocation. These funding applications should have gone to the Finance Committee instead of getting bundled with the appropriation bill. We could have had a chance to discuss it in the FC if they have gone to the FC, which is the right course. We try to be friendly. We ask government to give us information. I mean, we try to go easy because unless there are objections, we would not oppose the application going to the PWSC, the ESC, or the FC. We know that it would take time to line up, to prepare papers. If we do not indicate any objections, you can immediately send it to the queue, to the FC or PWSC, and then you use the time in between to prepare information. There are 20 items or so that the government have skipped this process. And so I want to separate these items and talk about them because you have bundled them up with the appropriation bill. If you continue with this poor practice, you are telling us not to be easygoing in panel meetings, that we should require you to give all information before we give you the green light to go to the queue. And this is what you're doing. You're undermining the relationship between the legislature and the executive. You make us realize that we have to be very stringent in every step of the way, otherwise it will end up like this. In the smart creative initiatives in one of the annex, it says that the funding is $110 million for this item, but when information is given about this initiative, it says that in order to enhance transparency, any items costing more than $10 million, it will have to be submitted to the FC. But you see that when it comes to $10 million, then he has to go to the FC, but if it is $110 million, it doesn't have to. You see how ridiculous it is. We're talking about a huge sum. So what about the transparency you talked about? How do you suppose we understand this line? In order to enhance transparency, anything over $10 million will have to be submitted to the FC. You take us for fools? So if you have to go through the procedure, go through the procedure.
Well, just now, Ma Fong Kwok expressed his admiration and envy of the creative industry taking off in Korea. Yes, they've done really well. Their content of the TV soap operas are quite nami-pami. And they're good if you're just having a dinner at the same time. It's just mindless television. But when it comes to some of the non-TV programs about the history of Korea, one about medicine, the other one about the Korean costume, they have spent a lot of time researching. It's not like our local television. There is a series about lawyers in court. Whenever it's broadcast, it always becomes the laughing stock in the legal circle. I think it shows how serious you are towards what you're doing. And that would affect the product. Well, the Secretary for Home Affairs is here, so I would like to take the opportunity to say this. This Create Smart initiative. You need all the departments to work together to promote the creative industry. Well, the Youth Square in Chai Wan, there are a lot of facilities that are not properly used. Say, for example, the audiovisual production room, the needlework room, the dance room. You can streamline the procedure of booking so that the hardware can be properly used. It will serve as an incubator for our youngsters so that our youngsters can tap into their potential. You don't have to be envious of Korea. In Korea, there is a children's museum and also a children's center. A large area for children to make plans, to play. Well, last time I talked to you about Youth Square, you did not reply to me. What about the tuition centers there? Should you use a Youth Square as a tuition center for helicopter parents to drill their children? And there's also a drawing, and painting room, and the students there are ankle biters. They're not youngsters. Are you telling me that you start your work not from youngsters but from a tender age? I would like you to reply to me about how you can make good use of the Create Smart initiatives and existing facilities in Hong Kong. How can you ensure that there is coordination and synergy so that we can catch up with Korea? And I want to talk about Amendment 367, RTHK, Head 160, and Subhead 603, non-recurrent, and a subhead 899 $10.8 million. That is to enhance terrestrial digital television production facilities. 18 months ago, the RTHK came to the FC to ask for funding of $6.1 billion to redevelop the broadcasting house, so that facilities can be enhanced to deal with
terrestrial and digital TV production and also broadcast stations. Well, the loyalists worked together to vote it down. So the big sum has been voted down. Now there is a small sum. I would like to ask the loyalists, how are you going to vote, for or against? If you agree with a continuous reduction, I'd like to hear from you, because I don't. I propose the reduction just to have a chance to have a discussion, because they have circumvented the FC. Now is the acid test. You can actually vote it down to continue your line from the $6.1 billion. ATV is down. RTHK has taken over from ATV, and they will use channels 31 and 32 and have their own production. Currently, the hours of service they provide is limited. Now, I want to ask the loyalists, see if they would vote on the $10.87 million. Please do not make a mistake and blame us. Let me tell you, it's number 376. It's one that is towards the end. I hope that we will get a few seconds to remind the loyalists to be careful when they cast their vote. And the $10.87 million is not enough for the RTHK to enhance their TV program production, be it manpower, soft or hardware. Well, the media has severely criticized it, and we have also asked the director of the RTHK. Don't think that if you sit someone who have experience with radio can be an anchor, because it's a completely different situation. You have to show the audience a clip when you give the information. So it takes more than someone with radio experience. Now, what's the situation now? Yes, someone will sit in front of the camera, but who is it? It's a year two journalism student. And that person's been given 20-minute training to tell the person how that machine operates. And they show the work of the information, and then ask her to do the work. But it's only year two. What is she supposed to do? Well, she is supposed to take the footage and then show it to a more senior reporter for a decision to be made as to what is to be done. Labour Party held a press conference, and we found that, well, at least about a study paper on putting an end to the ding right, to the indigenous male indigenous villager right. And that's when this year two girl showed up, and we realized that's how inadequate the resources are for the RTHK. We don't want to cut the $10.87 million. We say that that is not enough. But if you give us a chance to have a discussion in the FC, then we can have a proper dialogue with officials so that we can get across our point in an open meeting. But if you circumvent the FC, we have no choice but to do it like this so that we can talk about it in a council meeting. But there is no official here representing telecommunication and broadcasting. When you reply tomorrow, the public who are watching it may not know what is actually going on. It's very undesirable to bundle it up with the appropriation bill. We have no choice but to move amendments so that we can ask questions of the government and so that we can ask the secretary to reply. Mr. Ray Chan, thank you. Wong Kok Hing this morning said, filibustering comes to no avail, and he took the chance to list out the work of the FTU over the years. And I think every loyalist will have to copy Wong Kok Hing to speak and tell the public what they have done over the years. For some things, yes, he has successfully got them. Say, for example, that compensation of loss of one limb. Every single time he show us a severe severed limb. But when he said that he's been carrying a baby for 10 years and he successfully got the 3-day paid paternity leave. However, in 2012, he said he wanted 7 days. And I remember in December 2014, on the 18th, I remember that day very well, because usually we either vote for or against, but for the 6 votes of FTU, they only press present without pressing for or against.
They wouldn't even leave the meeting chamber to reduce the difficulty of getting it passed. And they did explain why they did so. It was said that the government would withdraw the proposal if the amendment was passed, and that's why they would have to pocket a 3-day offer first. Well, it's said that if some amendments are slipped through today through some reason, it would be doomsday. The reality is not like that. Even if just one amendment among the 700 has been passed, the government will just retract the bill. Well, you can say so. The government can explain if this is not what you are going to do. So the government can just do that. It's the how the government would deal with most bills. If an amendment that the government doesn't want, the bill can be withdrawn. And many loyalists have quoted this reason that, well, this proposal is at least a small sweetener, and we might as well have it. It's just like the constitutional reform package. And now the FTU wants to fight for 7 days of full pay paternity leave. I think at most the government will give you one more day, because you can quote the same reason that it's a case of take it or leave it. So you have it will take 4 terms, 20 years to get what you wanted in 2012. Well, if you fight for the labor rights with such a mentality, then we are doomed to fail. It's just like the minimum wage, it's just like the standard working hours. They can give you just 10 cents more, because it's more, or 50 cents more. Is the minimum wage rate is $32.50, right? After we have strived for it for so long. So I advise the FTU to be careful about your platforms. Although people have been trying to ridicule you, that is really about fighting for gay rights. But perhaps that would win you more support. I want to talk about 171, IPD. It's about cutting the docking the pay of the director. Last time I said that they pit fair dealing against fair use, thereby misleading the public and experts. According to net netizens, fair dealing cannot help with those who sing no song in a new way, and also the streaming of enthusiasts, and they said the commentary will be exempted. Well, if you are playing a game, it's just the Rubik's Cubes. What can I comment? That this yellow brick is it looks good, and that blue one also looks good. And if sing a song is a parody, is a mean to read, to satire, to do some satire. But well, that's the so-called red nose campaign, people wearing a red nose to show their dissatisfaction. So it's not good if you praise the author, but if you try to pull up a satire, that's okay. The only half of the dialogue in the community was held. We talk about contract override. And what did the director say? Let me refresh your memory. Well, parody and the satire would normally not be banned. But you download the games such as the Candy Rush. There will be a term that you cannot do anything about the game or the app, and the terms can be changed anytime they want. And according to the director, in a civil action, there must be proof of damages, so that they have to think carefully about taking civil action. It's just you're saying that give you a knife, give them a knife, they won't chop you with the knife lightly. They won't incur so much cost to do it. So don't worry, even though the contract may be unreasonable. As the director of the intellectual property, how can she adopt such an attitude? And there are some examples of open-ended exemptions in other jurisdictions, but it's not that we cannot consider it, but we need to carefully consider the views of different stakeholders, and there will be another round of review after the current bill is passed. And some people do buy that. And the Australian LLC has vetoed the idea of limited fair use. And the limited fair use was proposed by Mr. Dennis Kwok, and the Australian LLC has vetoed this in favor of the fair use that we were suggesting. So I have to tell the director this. When you reintroduce a bill, there will be more and more requests. You must have UGC, fair use, fair dealing, and people may still want more. 5 years later, things will be very different. Members have said that we have a long queue, so we are going to have a vote on this bill on the 11th of May, and then we have to deal with other bills, and if they are not very controversial, we'll deal with them one by one. But let's look at the cause of this situation. On the 8th of December 2015, we started to scrutinize the copyright amendment bill, and when it was the 4th of March 2016, Mr. Gretzel stood up and said that people should recognize the faces of these members. I said that it should be adjourned. No one is was ready. The community, the officials, and members here were not ready. And Mr. Gretzow said, we are ready. So the government ignored the views of members of this council and the community, and the government tried to ram it through in this council. The loyalists criticized the government for this. And if they had known what would happen, they shouldn't have done it like that. Was the time wasted? Well, there are difficult bills, there are easy bills, and if you present one, we have to deal with it, and we spend 4 months as a result on the bill. If we suspended that on the first occasion, and the government then considered a better way forward with the copyright owners, and then other members' bills will have time to be considered. So, if you ask whether a filibustering is ever useful, if the pandemocrats did not cooperate, and if the president did not act fairly, the bill would have been passed. So we have to tell people that we should do our utmost, even though the chances of success might be slow or might be low. I won't repeat the CY Leung incident, but you will not be able to hear the song of the officials involving again. It's on Facebook. Well, you can choose to upload it to YouTube. Other people may make a copy and upload the clip somewhere else, but there's no value in seeing it again. The director of IP then tried to explain things for CY Leung. Well, we should. I think everyone should admit one's mistake. When there's one, just like what Mion Lai has said, he should be blamed and not the FEHD. So this singing song, this song incident and the luggage incident, well, the CE relied on other people to protect him. When asked whether there was any infringement by CY Leung, the director said, you have to send your question to the CE's office. I don't know whether the consent of the copyright owner has been secured. What if there's no consent sought from the owner? The director said that it would be exempted under current reporting of current affairs. That's an exemption already in the current ordinance in respect of fair dealing. And he said, the CE is a public figure. I think we can get exemption based on reporting of current affairs. It may be possible. So she always used may. Whenever you ask her, she would ask you to consult your own lawyers. So the Facebook page of the CE, well, it's not a media. In other words, anyone who is a bit famous would be able to infringe copyright, because I can sing, I can copy a comic strip. The fact that this is a reporter can be considered current reporting of current affairs, and therefore the exemption applies. Isn't that absurd? AOs and civil servants have a tough job to do. My amendment is about docking the pay of the director. In trying to just market this Article 23 copyright bill, she said that we should not say it's like an Article 23 legislation. We should say that this is a bill with three or four advantages. I would say that if you are not sure, you should not give an answer to any question. And now her remarks are ridiculed, and it would mean that reintroducing a bill in the future will be made even more difficult.
多谢主席。